Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Honey, Mud, Maggots, and Other Medical Marvels, The Science Behind Folk Remedies and Old Wives' Tales, by Robert and MichelE Root-Bernstein, narrated by Nelson Runger. This work is copyrighted 1997 by Robert S. Root-Bernstein and MichelE R. Root-Bernstein. This recording is copyrighted 1998 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. Many modern medical practices, the use of clay in medications for diarrhea, the use of components of urine and fertility drugs, to name two, began as old wives' tales or folk remedies. Although this book describes a number of medically validated therapies currently used in modern hospitals that originated as folk treatments, this book should in no way be construed as recommending that lay people practice these therapies or other folk remedies on themselves or anyone else. Medicine should be practiced only by trained medical personnel. Many folk remedies, including the therapies described in this book, involve significant risks, and some are potentially fatal. If you desire to be treated in some of the ways we describe, see a trained physician for advice and care. Please note as well that the authors are not physicians and cannot dispense medical counsel of any kind. And now, Honey, Mud, Maggots, and Other Medical Marvels.
Introduction. Antique Modernities. Medicine is in a period of development of which we, the contemporaries, cannot grasp the full significance. But one thing is obvious, namely that what we lack is no longer facts, observations, experiments, new treatments. It is rather the philosophy of medicine that is going astray. It is all too apparent that, carried away, we too much neglect the lessons of medicine of all times and peoples. B. J. Stokvis, Ph.D., 1896. Imagine that you're lying in a hospital emergency room at a major university with a festering wound that's beginning to turn gangrenous. The doctor says, "First, I'm going to put some maggots in there to clean out the wound, and when they're through, I'll pack it with honey and cover it with some cellophane. It's the latest thing. You'll be up and about in no time." Or perhaps the group you're traveling with has had a car accident out in the desert. You have no medical supplies, not even water to drink. One of your companions has a fever and her temperature is dangerously high. You have sustained a deep cut that would normally require stitches. Fortunately, a medical intern is with you. He cleanses the wound with your urine, pulls the edges together with safety pins, and suggests that you lick the damaged flesh regularly to keep it moist as it heals. To treat the woman with the raging fever, he takes out his penknife, sterilizes it with a lit match, then proceeds to puncture a vein in her arm and withdraw more than a pint of blood. He claims he has just saved your lives. Or maybe you have high blood pressure and water retention due to some liver or kidney problem. Your internist says you don't need any pills. He recommends instead that you check into a spa for a month and sit up to your neck in water for a minimum of 1 hour twice a day. Oh, and drink lots of the local mineral water. That should do the trick. These scenes may sound preposterous, but they're not. They're based on treatments that have actually been used in hospital settings or emergency situations within the last few years, or on treatments that have recently accrued sufficient medical backing that they could be. All of them originated as folk remedies and have been employed for generations, even millennia. That they sound utterly preposterous to us today just goes to show how completely we have lost touch with the wisdom of the past. For thousands of years, medical knowledge was reverently passed on from generation to generation. Bloodletting, bathing in mineral springs, cleansing with urine, all these practices had long therapeutic lives in both folk and learned medicines in every part of the world. Few changes were made in the care and treatment of sickness and injury from the time the ancient Egyptians, Greeks, Hindus, and Chinese wrote down their first texts through the mid-19th century. Much of what was learned over this time resulted from the sharing of insights between cultures as travel and communication made the world ever smaller. Then, quite abruptly, the advent of scientific medicine in the later 1800s seriously undermined the unquestioned acceptance of past medical traditions. Rudyard Kipling caught the new spirit of these times when he wrote, "Wonderful little, when all is said, wonderful little our fathers knew. Half their remedies cured you dead. Most of their teaching was quite untrue." Suddenly, as Henry Ziegerist, a leading medical historian, put it, the history of medicine became the history of errors. So great was the enthusiasm for medical breakthroughs based upon the chemical analysis of drugs, systematic record-keeping, surgical innovations, and scientific research, and so boundless the optimism in medicine's future progress, that the past seemed to hold no value either for doctors or for their patients. The consequences of this shift in medical mindset are still with us today. Indeed, it's not uncommon for medical researchers and physicians to restrict their studies to the last 5 or 10 years of medical progress. Of the history of medicine, the average person is likely to know only the tall tales of supposedly nonsensical treatments such as phlebotomy, poultices, and purges. The non-scientific roots of medicine seem ever more ridiculous and ever more obscure. Such flippant rejection of many millennia of accumulated knowledge has its price, as does the rejection of traditional medicines from foreign cultures. Ignorance of the past has never been a firm foundation for the present. Medical history, wrote Ziegerist in 1951, is medicine also today as it was in the past. The proposition is not obvious, but it can be demonstrated. In the past, both ancient and recent, in Europe and around the world, general truths are still to be found. Common regimens and serendipitous cures can still be examined for present and future benefit. Today more than ever, Ziegerist said, there is need also for medical interpretations and evaluations of the past of medicine. This book is a serious exercise in this vein, but with a light-hearted twist. What follows is an anecdotal examination of a number of medicinal remedies from long ago or across the world that have influenced and continue to influence modern medical practice. These stories run the gamut from comedy to drama to romance, from triumph to failure, from discovery to denouement. They turn upon makeshift, foresight, curiosity, horror, hard work, and devotion. In each case, an ancient treatment we have been taught to ignore, abhor, or poke fun at is found making a comeback at the cutting edge of modern clinical practice. Separately, each tale tells of some obligation we bear toward the wisdom of other times and other places. Together, they tell us that medicine's past is the key to its present and its future. Above all, these stories spell out the evolutionary pattern of medical progress. With evolutionary theory as our guide, we can discern the biological origins of medicine and trace its subsequent cultural growth. We can look at the basic physiological urges that gave rise to primitive therapies and examine the cultural forces of selection and repression that limit the horizons of medicine. We can investigate the social pressures that encourage medical crackpots on the one hand and medical innovators on the other. We can begin to understand why medical remedies of any kind must fit the practitioner's minds and spirits in order to be both efficacious and utilized. Finally, we can learn from the past evolutionary course of medicine what we must do to shape its evolution in the future. The lessons of medical history, and how we may use them, are the subject of Honey, Mud, Maggots, and Other Medical Marvels. In sketching out this narrative, however, we have set severe limits on the old wives' tales and treatments we will discuss. We consider very few herbal remedies because the literature on herbal medicines and their histories is already large and compelling. One well-known academic press, CRC Publishers, has an entire ethnobotanical library. We also believe that the focus on herbal remedies has largely blinded physicians, medical historians, and the public to other branches of modern medicine that have been affected by folk wisdom. Of these, we wish to present only those treatments amply validated by recent medical practice. Our ultimate criterion has been, in fact, that accredited physicians working in established hospitals in industrialized countries use the treatment, or some historical offspring of the treatment, today. We firmly believe that medicine can benefit from folk wisdom only if the very highest clinical standards are maintained. Our purpose is not to convince the world that folk medicine is the answer to all the limitations faced by contemporary medical science. We are all too well aware that the majority of folk treatments do not work, or work less effectively than modern medicines. It would be foolish to throw out current practice without the most compelling of reasons. Rather, our purpose is to demonstrate the much more circumscribed thesis that ancient folk medicines have provided so many useful therapies that to ignore this fecund source of knowledge and practice is also foolish. We owe a profound medical debt to the past and to the multiple cultures of the world, and we should be proud to acknowledge it. We also have an obligation to maximize medicine's adaptive response to the rapidly changing world we anticipate in the 21st century. Traditional medicines in non-Western countries, as well as alternative medicines in Western popular culture, can offer catalysts for creative change in standard clinical practice. The systematic and serious review of these practices can prime the pump of medical innovation. Antique modernities mark a tried and true path toward discovery and rediscovery. We owe it to our children and our children's children to make the journey, to see where we have been, where we need to go, and how we can get there. Chapter 1. Old Wives' Tales and the Clinic. Although constantly practiced by primitive people for thousands of years, these methods have been recently rediscovered by learned men clothed in scientific principle and given to the world as new. George Engelman, Ph.D., 1884. One day, the teenaged Edward Jenner, apprentice to the English surgeon John Ludlow, went with his master to see a man whom Ludlow diagnosed as having smallpox. Greatly feared, smallpox killed many and often left those who survived forever scarred and even blind. The usual procedure was to send the family away, quarantine the patient, and find a nurse who had already survived the disease and therefore wouldn't catch it again. In this instance, however, one of the man's servants, a milkmaid, claimed she could take care of her sick master without harm because she had had the cowpox. Ludlow scoffed. Cowpox seriously affected cows and horses, but caused only mild symptoms in human beings. "They do say it protects against the smallpox," the girl replied. "Stuff and nonsense," warned Ludlow. Smallpox was another disease altogether, and the milkmaid ran a serious risk of catching it. Still, the girl persisted. "She had already nursed people sick with smallpox and been safe, sir." Ludlow threw up his hands and allowed her to stay. Afterward, Jenner asked if there might be something to this cowpox notion. "Put no credence in old wives' tales," Ludlow roundly scolded his apprentice. "The only safe way to prevent smallpox was variolization." Variolization was an inoculation procedure in which pus from a very light case of smallpox or variola was scratched into the skin of a healthy person. Usually, this person came down with a light case of smallpox, which more often than not protected against severe strains of the disease. Jenner already knew this, having been inoculated himself as a small boy. He may also have known that variolization had originated in the Orient 2,000 years earlier. The practice had been observed near the beginning of the 18th century by Lady Mary Wortley Montagu, wife of the British ambassador to Turkey. Although she had initially been appalled by the barbarity of purposefully transmitting such a horrible disease, she had had herself and her son variolized in 1717. On her return to England, she brought the practice with her, and for the most part it worked, although sometimes even a light case of smallpox could scar or maim or kill a person. Jenner was concerned. The best defense against smallpox was not without considerable risk. He was also intrigued. Variolization had been introduced to Europeans not by a properly accredited male physician, but by an untrained woman relying upon exotic ways. Perhaps a better method existed. Perhaps that better method was also to be found among the strange beliefs of untutored people. Perhaps there really was something to the local folklore that cowpox protected against smallpox. An idea that, as he began to practice on his own, he heard repeated on all sides. Jenner decided to see for himself. Despite the medical profession's disdain for old wives' tales, he began to keep track of what happened to patients who had contracted cowpox when they were later exposed to smallpox. One of his earliest cases concerned a farmer named Joseph Merritt, whom Jenner attended in 1770. Merritt developed an unusually severe cowpox infection that laid him up for several days. 5 years later, Jenner inoculated the farmer and his family with a weakened strain of smallpox as part of a general variolization campaign. The rest of Merritt's family became infected, but despite repeated inoculations, Merritt did not get sick from the weakened smallpox infection. Perhaps he really was protected. In 1785, Jenner found 5 more cowpox-infected farmhands and inoculated them with smallpox. None became ill. Excited by these results, Jenner summarized his 6 cases for the local medical society. He suggested inoculating people purposefully with cowpox to test his theory that it protected against smallpox. His fellow physicians, however, refused to entertain the notion. Folk wisdom, they told him, was dangerous nonsense. Though discouraged, Jenner persevered, collecting more and more cases. In 1792, he treated Sarah Portlock, who had become infected with cowpox while employed as a farm servant. Portlock's daughter contracted smallpox later that year, and Sarah nursed her. Because the case was light, and Sarah had already been exposed to her daughter's case, Jenner used pus from the daughter to inoculate Sarah. Despite repeated inoculations, she did not contract smallpox. Protection again. And so it went. Altogether, Jenner accumulated more than 100 instances of people who had had definitive cases of cowpox and had subsequently been exposed to smallpox without contracting it. Finally, during an outbreak of cowpox in 1796, Jenner took cowpox pus from the arms of Sarah Nelms, inoculated a young boy named James Phipps with it, and a few weeks later attempted to give the Phipps boy smallpox. How Jenner got permission from Phipps's parents to perform this experiment is not recorded, but Phipps did not get smallpox. He was protected, as Jenner had predicted. By now, Jenner believed he had enough data to convince his medical colleagues that cowpox inoculations would be safer and more effective than variolization. In 1798, he asked the Royal Society of London, the premier scientific institution in Great Britain and indeed the world, to sponsor his results. The answer was no. Jenner had no choice but to publish his breakthrough as a pamphlet at his own expense. He subsequently endured years of unkind treatment from both colleagues and public before his ideas were finally accepted. Today, of course, Jenner is known as the inventor of vaccination, a term derived from the Latin word vacca, or cow. And due to his invention, smallpox itself has been eradicated worldwide. Indeed, vaccination for this and many other diseases may very well save more lives every year than any other medical procedure invented since. Jenner's discovery was surely a case in which folk wisdom yielded a nugget of truth that the modern world could hardly do without. Another 18th century physician, by the name of William Withering, also found medicine in old wives' tales. He turned an interest in the folk medicinal use of plants into the discovery of digitalis. Like Jenner, Withering was wise enough to realize what he and his profession did not know, and that was how to treat heart disease. His ignorance was brought home to him sharply by a patient he treated in 1775. The elderly woman had dropsy, a severe swelling of the lower limbs. A modern doctor would probably diagnose the cause as congestive heart failure, in which the heart pumps too feebly to maintain adequate circulation of blood. Withering knew that the woman had not long to live, and he apparently prescribed no treatment. Imagine his surprise, therefore, when a few weeks later he inquired after her health and learned that she had recovered from her illness. He asked the old woman to what she attributed her miraculous recovery. "Herb tea," she replied, supplied by a neighbor renowned for curing problems that physicians often were unable to treat. Upon further questioning, the old woman produced the recipe, and Withering decided to test it for himself. Withering found that the tea contained some 20 herbal ingredients. Among them, he quickly identified foxglove, known botanically as Digitalis purpurea, and a staple of folk remedies from at least the Middle Ages, as the only ingredient capable of reducing a dropsical swelling. Foxglove increased urination and vomiting, and thus, Withering reasoned, reduced the volume of blood and of fluid in the body. He began experimenting with foxglove extracts of various strengths, using them on the poor people he treated for free. and he verified that foxglove extracts were in fact very beneficial for almost all patients suffering from dropsy, but for different reasons than he had expected. The preparations directly stimulated the heart rate, thereby improving the circulation of the blood. Withering collected hundreds of observations and published them in 1785 in An Account of the Foxglove and Some of Its Medical Uses. As a result of publicity caused by Charles Darwin's grandfather's claiming the discovery for his prematurely deceased son, the use of foxglove or digitalis for congestive heart failure was quickly established. Today, it is still widely prescribed for the same purpose. Indeed, although the chemical makeup of digitalis is now known, the common foxglove plant and closely related species continue to be the basic source from which pharmaceutical companies extract the drug and its derivatives. Nature sometimes turns out to be a better chemist than human chemists, just as old wives sometimes turn out to be better pharmacists than the professionals. If Jenner and Withering were unique, we wouldn't have much of a narrative. But they are not. Despite the tremendous advances made by synthetic chemists and pharmacologists in the modern era of antibiotics, chemotherapies, and anesthetics, much of our pharmacopoeia, our collection of drugs and medicinal preparations, and a good deal of our medical technique and expertise, too, have been acquired from folk practice. The medical historian Erwin Ockernecht has, in fact, characterized the 18th century as a period in which the breakdown of social barriers and the rise of the middle classes in Europe lowered intellectual barriers separating learned medicine from that of everyday folk. Knowledge seeped slowly but steadily from untrained practitioners to medical professionals such as Jenner and Withering, and back again. Cowpox protection and digitalis were only two of dozens of discoveries arising from this process. The medicinal use of cod liver oil began as a Scandinavian folk remedy for rickets, scrofulas, and other wasting diseases, including tuberculosis. The oil's active ingredients were eventually identified as vitamins A and D, which are now known to be effective against the very diseases for which cod liver oil was most commonly prescribed in the past. Another worthy folk practice was the ingestion of fresh fruit, especially citrus, to prevent scurvy, the efficacy of which was demonstrated in controlled studies by the Scottish physician James Lind in 1747. The active ingredient, vitamin C, was discovered 200 years later. Folk wisdom outside of Europe was also mined for medical gold. Andean Indians had employed cinchona bark for centuries before Spanish explorers first encountered the fever tree, from which the antimalarial drug quinine was eventually extracted. During the 19th century, many other discoveries based upon primitive medical traditions made their appearance in the Western medical canon. Among these, the use of willow bark, a source of the salicylic acid upon which aspirin is based, has been traced back 3,500 years to an ancient Egyptian document known as the Abers Papyrus. The use of dried sap from the opium poppy has a similarly long medical history, long predating the isolation from opium of morphine, a stronger painkiller, by Frederick Sertürner in 1806. And wabeyan, a steroid hormone employed against cardiac arrhythmias, has been used from time out of mind by East African tribes for both medical purposes and, in much more concentrated doses, as a poison for their spears and arrows. The process of discovery continues to this day. Taxol, a recently discovered anti-cancer agent derived from the Pacific yew tree, has been a part of concoctions used by Native Americans for countless generations. An ancient Chinese chemical remedy for fever has yielded the active ingredient arsenic trioxide, which has been used for decades in veterinary medicine to treat parasitic and blood diseases. Recent research reveals that arsenic trioxide is the most effective treatment yet found for a rare blood cancer called acute promyelocytic leukemia. Modern medical science has substantiated many other common folk beliefs as well. Perhaps you've heard that drinking cranberry juice may help treat a urinary tract infection. Indeed, it may, and so might blueberries. Pharmacologists have recently isolated a compound from both berries that interferes with the ability of bacteria to attach to the bladder. And if your great aunt ever suggested placing a brewed tea bag on your eye to treat a sty, she was probably right. Black teas have been found to contain active antibiotics. The Chinese and Japanese have long recommended green tea for many ills, and recent research has shown that it may indeed have some anti-cancer activity. Almost certainly, it protects teeth from decay. The Chinese have an old saying, "When you eat a sweet, drink green tea." Someday, a group of chemicals called hexanes, the cavity fighters found in green tea, may end up in your toothpaste. The list of efficacious folk medicines is so long that it would take an entire book just to summarize them. In fact, in 1970, Virgil Vogel studied the origins of drugs then listed in two standard guides, the Pharmacopoeia of the United States of America and the National Formulary. He found some 120 substances that had been used previously by Indians of North and Central America. Dr. Maurice Gordon found further that at least 59 of these had not been known to Europeans until they came into contact with American Indians. If we assume, as further evidence suggests, an equal number of drugs originating in other cultures around the world, the list of medically validated folk cures that have become part of the modern pharmacopoeia is immensely long. It has been estimated that as many as half of the drugs, prescription and over-the-counter, currently available to physicians in the West began as old wives' tales or concoctions used by so-called primitive peoples. According to a tally kept by one pharmaceutical company, of the 121 prescription drugs currently derived just from plant materials, as opposed to chemical synthesis, 74% came from following up native folklore claims. Medicine has benefited not only from the drug lore of primitive and ancient peoples, but also from their knowledge of surgical techniques and disease processes. Ancient Egyptian medical papyri show that broken bones were immobilized with bandages soaked in cream and bean flour or other materials that hardened as they dried. Such casts were used for thousands of years before the invention of plaster of Paris. The Edwin Smith surgical papyrus, which dates to 1700 BC, describes the even more difficult and delicate treatment of a broken nose by packing it with soft material and covering with an adhesive plaster, just as we might do today. And recent analysis of surgical reconstructive methods in India 1500 years before Christ has found that Hindu surgeons had worked out all of the basic procedures now used for nasal reconstruction. European contact with the Americas revealed that native Indians were hundreds if not thousands of years ahead of their more civilized counterparts in the medical treatment of childbirth. Not only did the Amerindians use various methods to alleviate pain, including alcohol and narcotic drugs, and in severe cases, partial suffocation to relax the mother. But they worked out the basic methods for expelling a withheld placenta long before European doctors did. George Engelman, a 19th century physician who made a special study of American Indian medical practices, remarked that all too often his contemporaries thought they had invented treatments that he found to be as old as the world. Native Americans had also realized, by the time Europeans invaded their lands, that whatever caused putrefaction in a warrior's wounds or caused illness in a woman who had given birth was transmissible to others. They therefore isolated the injured and newborns and their mothers in individual huts. Each patient was cared for by a single individual who was forbidden to treat anyone else at the same time. As a result, puerperal or childbirth fever was very rare among Indians, even while it decimated women of European descent. And while hundreds of thousands, perhaps even millions, of men died during our frontier wars and the Civil War of infected wounds, or had to have limbs amputated due to gangrene, physicians in the Old West noted that very few Indians similarly injured in battle suffered the same fate. Many European physicians believed that the Indians' treatment of wounds was far superior to their own. This opinion was common enough that it fueled the popular rage for Indian medicine wagons and Indian medicine shows in the last decades of the 19th century. Unfortunately, only the medicines were mimicked, and not the equally important procedures of isolation and individualized care. Otherwise, Western medicine might have recognized earlier that centralizing medical care also centralizes the sources of infection and makes their spread more efficient. As the Indians proved, one does not need to know about germs in order to make crucial observations and act rationally upon them to save lives. A good case can in fact be made that medical science might have understood various modes of disease transmission substantially sooner than it did if researchers had paid attention to folk wisdom. Drawing on local tales, the Cuban physician, Carlos Finlay, suggested that yellow fever was carried by mosquitoes several decades before Walter Reed finally thought to test the insight in 1901. Similarly, the explorer Richard F. Burton wrote in the 1850s that the Somali people blamed mosquitoes for other fever-causing diseases from the fact that mosquitoes and fevers become formidable about the same time. 40 years elapsed, however, before Sir Ronald Ross traced the spread of malaria to the pesky insects, thereby earning a Nobel Prize. In these cases, intuition was initially rejected as superstition. But sometimes, superstition deserves careful study. If but one physician had seized upon Finlay's suggestion or Burton's footnote, as Withering seized upon the tea that cured an old woman, or as Jenner followed up on the chance remark of a milkmaid, how much sooner might yellow fever and malaria have yielded to public health controls? More important, how many equally revealing clues from odd sources are being overlooked at this very moment because they don't fit our preconceived notions of disease causation or treatment? Think about Augusto and Micaela Odone, whose son lay dying from amyotrophic leukodystrophy, or ALD. With no medical training, these well-educated parents developed an unusual dietary treatment, Lorenzo's oil, that arrested the progress of that debilitating disease, despite hostility from the medical community. Some physicians have adopted Lorenzo's oil as a way to slow the progress of ALD while they continue to look for a cure. But as a society, we are no more likely to acknowledge the insights of dedicated laymen than we are to accept those of untutored folk. This is not to say that such insights are always overlooked or scorned by experts. Indeed, a generation ago, a purposeful search for medical folk wisdom was undertaken by Dr. Richard Schultes, a director of the Botanical Museum of Harvard University, and his doctoral student, Ziri von Reis-Altschul, subsequently a professor of pharmacology. Schultes spent more than a decade after World War II exploring the wilderness of the Amazon River Basin and gathering plant specimens and tribal lore concerning their uses. Altschul, meanwhile, delved into the centuries-old collections and records of the Arnold Arboretum and Gray Herbarium of Harvard, where she found hundreds upon hundreds of anecdotes concerning the medicinal or food uses of little-known plants. Together, these investigators found that related species of plants from very different locations were often used by the local cultures for the same medical purposes. Modern chemical research has identified in many of these plants active compounds that have served as the bases of new experimental drugs. When Michael Ballack, director of the Institute of Economic Botany of the New York Botanical Garden, sampled the garden's plant specimens from around the world for extracts that could be used against human immunodeficiency virus, HIV, he found that plants identified by native healers as being powerful were four times more likely to have general antiviral activity than those chosen at random. Several compounds derived from these plants are now being developed for further testing by the National Cancer Institute. That is pretty impressive, since none of the native healers, many interviewed by plant collectors more than a century ago, had ever heard of viruses or of AIDS. Given these surprising results, growing numbers of researchers have in recent years focused on culling folk medicines for modern medical insights. The ethnobotanist Paul Allen Cox, for instance, has spent the last decade gathering the medical knowledge of local healers in Tonga, Fiji, Australia, Africa, Costa Rica, and, most often and by preference, Samoa. Some of his botanical specimens have already yielded disease-fighting drugs. Nor is Cox alone. There are enough professionals interested in non-Western medical traditions to support journals of ethnobotany, ethnomedicine, and ethnopharmacology, as well as journals and books on alternative medicines. Schultes, now the old man of the field, has recently founded an ethnobotanical conservation institute to centralize such efforts. One pharmaceutical company, based in San Marcos, California, actually specializes in tracking down folk cures and turning them into modern medicines. Shaman Pharmaceuticals has already delivered several drugs derived from ethnobotanical sources to clinical trial. These recent successes have spurred some 200 pharmaceutical companies and research institutions worldwide into investigating plants as sources of useful drugs. Traditional medicines serve as a starting point. Even the United States government has gotten into the act with the recent founding of the Office of Alternative and Non-Traditional Medicine within the Department of Health and Human Services. Since a majority of Americans self-treat with remedies originating outside the modern medical tradition prior to visiting a physician, it's high time that we study folk medicines and alternative therapies more thoroughly. If nothing else, physicians need to understand the treatments their patients choose to use and why they do so. Whether alternative medical treatments are valid is, of course, a different question altogether. Some are undoubtedly nonsensical, if not downright harmful, as we discuss in Chapter 17, Crackpots and Panaceas. Others no doubt contain a grain of truth as useful as those recognized by Jenner and Withering. As long as we remain ignorant of the facts of each case, we cannot distinguish between the two. It won't be easy to overcome our ignorance. No one, least of all a trained professional, is comfortable with the unfamiliar, as many of our examples here and in the following chapters will show. Most physicians reacted negatively to Jenner's idea of vaccination and to Withering's foxglove tea. They ignored what the American Indians knew about close quarters and contagion, what Finlay and others suggested about insects and fever, what the Odones learned about diet and ALD. And, as we will see in subsequent chapters, physicians have turned up their noses at the medical use of maggots, sugar, and leeches, poo-pooed deep water bathing, and gagged at the thought and smell of pus. Resistance to innovation is natural, deeply ingrained in all of us. Consider your own reactions to the following case. Imagine yourself a physician. A farmer comes into your office and tells you he thinks he has heartburn. You ask whether he has ever been evaluated for a heart condition, which can have similar symptoms and would be much more serious. He says yes, but the problem has been taken care of. When you inquire further, he reveals that 10 years earlier he was diagnosed as having heart palpitations and was put on a drug that sounds like quinine. You interpret that to mean he had a heart arrhythmia treated by quinidine. After taking the drug for a few months, the symptoms went away, so the farmer stopped taking the drug. Then the symptoms came back. The farmer no longer had the drug, so he just bore the pain and went off to do his daily chores. In the course of his work, he had to replace a downed electrical wire that ran around his pasture to keep the cows from straying. As he stood in the wet grass, he grasped the wire in both hands without thinking. Instantly, he felt a shock and found himself lying on his back. His heart problem had disappeared, though. So every time the farmer felt his symptoms returning, he'd shock himself on purpose. It was so effective, he even ran a line from the fence into his basement for easier access to his unusual remedy. Do you take this man's story seriously? Is he a jerk or a genius? Would you try his treatment on yourself or your other patients? Should you search for a possible ulcer, or should you suggest psychiatric treatment instead? Might he have made up this story to pull your leg, or is it for real? The farmer is for real. And the story is told by Dr. Jerry H. Burke of Acton, Massachusetts, who thinks the farmer was extraordinarily clever. "I most probably would have dismissed his tale as so much colorful folklore," he writes, "if I hadn't known that an electric shock passed across the chest could effectively resolve cardiac arrhythmias." The farmer had simply reinvented for himself a treatment that has been known to physicians for decades, and that is the basis for the heroic efforts you see on TV, when the emergency room physician claps the paddles onto the chest of a fibrillating heart patient and yells, "Clear!" Dr. Burke's punchline, however, is this: "I have to wonder what other potentially useful therapeutic modalities have been similarly dismissed by me and my learned colleagues." And well he might. Norman Casting, whose foray into the history of medicine we will discuss in Chapter 6, recounts his own initial refusal to consider medical evidence simply because it originated in the past. "I was often given the advice to familiarize myself with the works of the early pioneers in my field. My supervisors were determined that I should gain some perspective on my own research. At first, I paid relatively little heed to their kindly admonitions, scarcely believing that research done 20 years ago, much less 100 years ago, could be very meaningful to current research problems. The mere mention of papers from 1883 conjured up images of aging and slightly senile medical historians cloistered in darkened rooms full of dusty old manuscripts and muttering medieval words such as phlogiston or plethora to themselves. I wondered how relevant this old stuff could be, when they didn't even have oxygen analyzers, data acquisition systems, oscilloscopes, or radioimmunoassays. At first, Casting's forays into the archives seemed to confirm his preconceptions, leaving him with the feeling that I was wasting valuable time that could otherwise be used to push back the frontiers of knowledge. Such feelings are prevalent. Surely the laboratory is where discoveries are made, not the library or the ethnographic records of some primitive shaman or the recipes of half-educated housewives or the cockamamie story of some farmer. But much of the dis-ease with the past and the unfamiliar comes from not knowing what to look for or how to go about it. Once one becomes fluent in library skills, interviewing, and in the disconcerting and sometimes baroque disquisitions of laymen, new worlds of experience suddenly become accessible. It wasn't long, Casting writes, before I discovered just how useful these carefully written chronicles of early physiology could be. The dialogue between modern medicine and folk practice works because they both have, in fact, a common goal. Every culture on earth has needed medicines and medical treatments, and all have experimented with the resources available to them. As a result, a process of trial and error has been going on for thousands, perhaps hundreds of thousands, of years. Therapies that worked were retained and passed down from generation to generation. Those that did not work were discarded, and something else was tried instead. Ancient remedies that have withstood this test of time, especially those that have survived in many cultures around the world, have, we believe, a high probability of effectiveness. Once we understand how they work, these remedies can be used to enhance the range and flexibility of modern medicine. Like Casting, the best professionals recognize that regardless of credentials, anyone in any culture who is committed to solving an outstanding medical problem may have an intuition that leads to a promising treatment or cure. Indeed, given the extraordinarily limited means available to contemporary native healers and past practitioners in terms of knowledge, technology, and technique, the results they have achieved are often quite astounding. Few of us are as inventive or insightful as the medical innovators hidden in the past, the bush, the farm, or even the urban jungle. But we can push the frontiers of our own medicine by culling what is useful from the accumulated wisdom of shamans and laymen alike. The road from old wives' tales to the modern clinic is still being paved with solutions to many of mankind's most pressing medical problems. Chapter 2. A Fly-Blown Idea. While it is natural to look to future research to provide new modalities of therapy, one should not overlook successes of the past. One such technique of the pre-antibiotic era for treatment of suppurative infections was the use of maggots. Carl Lawrence Horn, M.D., Albert H. Cobb, Jr., M.D., and George A. Gates, M.D., 1976. Medical treatments are rarely pretty, at least to the untrained or unaccustomed eye. When they come in unusual forms and from unusual sources, even physicians can be shocked. Dr. William A. Nolan learned this lesson early in the 1950s at Bellevue Hospital in New York City. On his first day as a resident in the outpatient department, Nolan was taken in hand by a nurse known as Riley, a no-nonsense type who set him straight on the alcoholics and drug addicts who came to the clinic with leg ulcers. "Be tough," she told him. The first couple of patients needed only a dressing change. A third required admission to the hospital. Then Riley began unwrapping the bandaged leg of a man covered in filth and grime. "As she took away the last layer of gauze," Nolan recalled, "I saw, crawling around on 3 inches of bare bone, a swarm of maggots. I almost vomited." Riley, though, had seen it all. She calmly dosed the maggots with ether, causing them to roll up and out of the wound. What she said next shocked Nolan almost as much as his first sight of the crawling mass itself. "Those maggots sure keep an ulcer clean." Nolan, who had been too distressed to do more than glance at the wound, looked more closely. Sure enough, the maggots seemed to have eaten only dead tissue, leaving the ulcer looking red and healthy. Even so, Nolan needed a breath of fresh air. Since ancient times, the infestation of human flesh by maggots has been considered a repugnant affliction. Riley, however, had pointed out a phenomenon repeatedly observed, forgotten, and rediscovered over the centuries. Sometimes maggots do good in a wound rather than harm. "Not much to look at," Riley conceded, "but they do the job." Those maggots, of course, were the larvae of flies that lay their eggs on raw or rotting flesh. And it's likely that their beneficial medical effects on open wounds were first observed in prehistoric times. We know that in the early part of this century, the Ngemba tribe of New South Wales, Australia, commonly used maggots to cleanse suppurating or gangrenous wounds. The Aborigines traced the treatment back to their remote ancestors. The same may be true of certain isolated hill people in Burma, observed around World War II, placing maggots on wounds and then covering them with mud and wet grass. Ancient records suggest that the Maya Indians of Central America ceremonially exposed dressings of beef blood to the sun before applying them to certain superficial tumors. After a few days, the dressings were expected to pulsate with maggots. The evidence, though slim, is tantalizing. For thousands of years, perhaps, in areas of the world as far apart as the Americas, Asia, and Australia, people have used maggots as medicine. We need not tramp so far afield as the bush or the rainforest, however, to find comprehension of a beneficial association between man and maggot. At the Battle of Saint-Quentin, France, in 1557, the barber surgeon Ambroise Paré observed firsthand that the wounds of the hurt people were greatly stinking and full of worms with gangrene and putrefaction. Paré did not know that the worms were fly larvae. He believed that they spontaneously generated from the corruption of rotting flesh. But he did treat at least one traumatic maggot-infested wound in which the patient recovered beyond all men's expectation. This is considered the first European recognition of the maggot's medical industry. It was by no means the last. Over the next 300 years, the efficacy of maggots was sporadically noticed, most especially by Napoleon's famous military surgeon, Dominique Jean Larrey. During the French expedition in Egypt, the majority of injured soldiers with suppurating wounds were, according to Larrey, much annoyed by the worms or larvae of the blue fly peculiar to that climate. Larrey and his medical staff tried unsuccessfully to convince the soldiers that the maggots merely cut short the process of nature and promoted healing by eating the dead and dying flesh. Nevertheless, when they changed dressings, the medical men made every effort to cleanse the wounds and prevent reinfestation. Obviously, it's one thing to notice that maggots serendipitously aid in the healing process of severe wounds. It's another to use them deliberately as therapeutic agents. Although Australian Aborigines, Burmese hill people, and the Maya Indians seem to have made the leap long ago, in Western medicine the purposeful use of maggots to clean wounds dates back only to the mid-19th century in France and in the United States. The American experience was again tied to fields of battle, for during the Civil War, miasis, or natural infestation of wounds, was a common if awful sight. Many Army surgeons recognized the maggot's beneficial effects, but a Confederate physician, John Forney Zacharias, was the first to use maggots purposefully to remove the gangrenous flesh of his hospital patients. "During my service at Danville, Virginia," he wrote, "I first used maggots to remove the decayed tissue in hospital gangrene, and with eminent satisfaction. In a single day, they would clean a wound much better than any agents we had at our command. I used them afterwards at various places. I am sure I saved many lives by their use, escaped septicemia, and had rapid recoveries." Subsequent therapeutic use of maggots was hindered, however, by several factors. To begin with, there are some 80,000 known species of flies, at least four large families of which feed on animal protein during their larval stage. For every species of maggot that feeds only on dead and dying tissue, there is another that feeds indiscriminately on both dead or living flesh, and yet another that feeds primarily on living flesh. Unfortunately, a number of these flies and their maggots look very much the same. Without some means to distinguish among them, the deliberate use of maggots could do harm as easily as good. Moreover, even the right flies and their maggots can infect a wound. The discovery of germs and the invention of the germ theory of disease by Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch during the 1880s altered forever the physician's willingness to introduce contaminating agents into the body. The germ theory was quickly followed by the development of antiseptic technique, revolutionizing the treatment of wounds. Under the best conditions, the use of chemical dressings and bandaging procedures significantly improved recovery. By the late 19th century, no one in the medical profession actively promoted the purposeful use of maggots, though some evidence exists that accidental infestation of wounds in hospital wards was both tolerated and appreciated. Then World War I introduced a new generation of physicians to types of wounds and conditions of filth few had ever experienced. Unless the wounded received immediate surgical care, virulent infection set in. Antiseptic techniques were not enough. Mortality among the wounded reached 75%. Given these desperate circumstances, more than a few military surgeons noticed that in cases of delayed treatment, those wounds did best that had been naturally infested with fly larvae. At least one suggested raising a brood of tame maggots, a piece of advice considered a jest, although rumor had it that many American physicians at the front really were attempting to induce maggot infestation. One surgeon, William Bayer, took his wartime observations to heart. Two men under his care had lain on the battlefield for 7 days. By the time they reached the hospital, their very severe wounds were crawling with maggots. Yet the men had no fever, no infection, and no gangrene. When the maggots were removed, Bear saw the most beautiful pink granulation tissue that you can imagine. The wounds were actually healing. Bear never forgot that sight, even after he returned to the hygienic conditions of peacetime medicine. As clinical professor of orthopedic surgery at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine, he specialized in osteomyelitis, a debilitating and painful infection of the bones. In many cases, the pus-filled, ulcerating sores became chronic, lasting from 4 to 10 years and more. The duration of the disease was all the more disturbing because so many of the sick were children. Moreover, the standard therapy of surgical debridement, the cutting away of infected or dying tissue, followed by rounds of antiseptic dressing, was all too often ineffective. Multiple surgical interventions were necessary, and as with war wounds, the eventual mortality was high. In 1929, after mulling the problem over for a decade, Bayer decided to use maggots in his civilian practice. Bayer began by recreating the natural conditions of infestation he had witnessed on the battlefield. He selected 21 patients with chronic osteomyelitis, opened their lesions surgically, removing as much dead tissue as possible, and packed the wounds to stop the bleeding. No chemical aseptic agents were used. The following day, he filled the wounds with what he called a viable antiseptic, as many maggots of the local blowfly as the wounds would hold. The maggots were replaced every 4 days for 6 or 7 weeks, during which time dead and dying tissue was eaten away and healthy new granulation tissue began to grow. The maggots not only did a better job of debridement than the surgeons, they actually seemed to foster the healing process. There was no purulent odor, no pus, no scar tissue. The bacterial count diminished rapidly, and the wound turned a healthy alkaline. At the end of 2 months, all 21 cases were completely healed. Bayer's maggot trial had proved to be the quickest and most successful treatment of chronic osteomyelitis then known to medical science. Bayer died 2 years later in 1931, but not before convincing many skeptical physicians that maggots could provide a scientifically sound and medically palatable therapy. The two concerns went hand in hand. To allay the disgust of patients and staff, Bayer constructed bulky mesh cages for the wounds, thus confining the maggots and hiding them from view. The continuous movement of the maggots caused an intense itching, which Bayer relieved by dressing the skin around the wound. When several of the patients being treated came down with clinical tetanus, Bayer immediately recognized the problem of contamination from naturally raised maggots. He and his associates began breeding blowflies in the laboratory and worked out meticulous procedures for sterilizing their eggs for clinical use. Enthusiastic medical colleagues soon adapted and improved on the Bayer technique in their own clinics. Government entomologists helped by identifying fly species and learning their physiology and optimal culture. Everyone wanted to avoid the horrible mistake made in one hospital that accidentally bred screwworm flies whose larvae ate living, not necrotic or dying flesh. Not surprisingly, many surgeons adamantly refused to give maggots a chance, despite suggestions that the treatment by some other name, larval therapy, for instance, would smell sweeter. Part of their resistance was due to the fact that no one really knew for sure how maggots managed to heal wounds. Various hypotheses postulated that they mechanically irritated wound tissue, that they stimulated the production of blood serum, that they secreted some metabolic active principle, all with beneficial effect. In the hopes that the active principle could be extracted and used independently of the maggots themselves, larvae were ground into solution to produce wound dressings and vaccines inoculated under the skin. Further research isolated allantoin, urea, and ammonium bicarbonate in maggot excretions, and dressings made of these substances did have beneficial effects on wounds. No evidence whatsoever vindicated the maggot vaccine, and the idea quickly got lost in the 100 or more papers written on maggot therapy between 1930 and 1940. In the end, efforts to sanitize the maggot, both literally and figuratively, met with success. Within a few years of Bayer's first trial, live maggots were being used in more than 300 hospitals in Canada and the United States. Surgeons abroad began to take notice. A dentist in New Jersey, desperate to join the bandwagon, announced his impractical intention to use maggots in root canal procedures. And at least two pharmaceutical houses, including Lederle Laboratories, began to mass-produce germ-free maggots for clinical use. Lederle even advertised their new product in the Journal of the American Medical Association. Despite its repugnant associations, the maggot worked better, 38% better, one physician reported, than any other known therapy to heal chronic festering wounds.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.